Greetings. Let's examine a few scriptures that describe Jesus as he comes back. I was going to say God is not the author of confusion. 1 Corinthians 14:33. For God is not the author of confusion, but of peace, as in all churches of the saints. Except this verse speaks of the context of church. 1 Corinthians 14 speaks of the spiritual gifts of the Holy Spirit and their proper, orderly manifestation within church services. 1 Corinthians 14:20, brothers, stop being childish in your thinking. Be like infants or innocent with respect to evil, but think like adults. In the law it is written, by men of strange tongues and by the lips of strangers I will speak to this people. And even so they will not listen to me, says the Lord. Isaiah 28:11. Very well then, with foreign lips and strange tongues God will speak to this people. God completes, fulfills, the message of the Old Testament prophets in the New Testament. Suffice it to say that 1 Corinthians 14 is a complete teaching on order in the church, meaning church services, assemblies. Therefore, if the whole church assembles together and all speak in tongues, and ungifted men or unbelievers enter, will they not say you are mad? Order is an important element of the witness of the church. So I was tempted to misapply God is not the author of confusion. And this is a good lesson on not leaning too heavily on only one verse of Scripture. Matthew 13:34. All these things Jesus spoke to the crowds in parables, and he did not speak to them without a parable. This was to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. I will open my mouth in parables. I will utter things hidden since the foundation of the world. Psalm 78, verse 2. I will open my mouth with a parable. I will utter hidden things, things from of old. God completes, fulfills the message of the Old Testament prophets by Jesus in the New Testament. Therefore, I speak to them in parables, because while seeing they do not see, and while hearing they do not hear, nor do they understand. In their case, the prophecy of Isaiah is being fulfilled, which says, you will keep on hearing, but will not understand. You will keep on seeing, but will not perceive. From Isaiah 6:9, he said, go and tell this people, be ever hearing, but never understanding. Be ever seeing, but never perceiving. Sorry, that was kind of off topic. My point is that sometimes God is the author of confusion. And in the last days, the following will be fulfilled. 2 Thessalonians 2:11. For this reason, God will send them a powerful delusion, so that they will believe the lie. But if you read the context, God does this because they did not love the truth. This condemnation to delusion is a judgment on those who receive it. But I would say God is not the author of confusion among believers. How then do we deal with scriptures like the following? 1 Thessalonians 4:17. Then we who are alive and remain will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so we shall always be with the Lord. In this reference to the return of Jesus, we meet him in the air. We'll be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. Now, a critical, persnickety reading does not say where we go after meeting him. It could be to heaven, or it could be to Jerusalem. But Prophet Zechariah described other details. Behold, the day of the Lord cometh, and thy spoil shall be divided in the midst of thee. I think we would agree to a single meaning of the day of the Lord. For I will gather all the nations against Jerusalem to battle, and the city will be captured, the houses plundered, the women ravished, and half of the city exiled, but the rest of the people will not be cut off from the city. We see the rise of national anti-Semitism building now. All nations, even their lost friend, America.com. Then the Lord will go forth and fight against those nations, as when he fights on a day of battle. In that day, his feet will stand on the Mount of Olives, which is in front of Jerusalem on the east, and the Mount of Olives will be split in its middle from east to west by a very large valley, so that half of the mountain will move toward the north and the other half toward the south. It seems very hard to me to envision a scenario where Jesus is already here, has already returned, and walks calmly over to the Mount of Olives from somewhere else in Jerusalem, then having the mount split between his feet as he stands there. Maybe it happens that way. I've just never considered it being that undramatic, unspectacular. Matthew 24:30, and then the sign of the Son of Man will appear in the sky, and then all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of the sky with power and great glory. I had always thought this appearing continued with Jesus landing on the Mount of Olives, then dismounting his blazing white steed. Revelation 19:11. And I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and he who sat on it is called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he judges and wages war. Verse 16, and on his robe and on his thigh he has a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Honestly, I have grouped the day of the Lord together with the sign of the Lord. Maybe that is a wrong association of events that are truly unlinked and unrelated. Independent of that, we have these two distinct images of the return of the Lord. We meet him in the clouds to be with him forever. He returns on horseback, also in the clouds, to come deal justice. I assume clouds, because it says, and I saw heaven opened, and behold. As we ponder and meditate on these and other descriptions, we must consider whether these are conflicting or are contradictory descriptions of the same event. Or might they reasonably be descriptions of two distinct, different events? That is a rational and reasonable consideration. And I think it makes more sense that there are two events. Rather than complicate the imagined scenario to involve us rising to meet Jesus on his white horse, then proving or disproving whether we be part of the armies of heaven. Revelation 19:14, and the armies which are in heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, were following him on white horses. It would seem these are the angelic host. 1 Kings 22:19. But Micah responded, therefore listen to what the Lord has to say. I saw the Lord sitting on his throne, and the entire heavenly army was standing around him on his right hand and on his left hand. But then do the resurrected believers, who rose to meet him in the clouds, just float around and watch events? I just have a hard time harmonizing the description of the last day, sign of the Son of Man, and what is going on with the freshly resurrected believers. There are some scriptures describing the resurrection, which I believe are easily and innocently confused with the rapture. John 6:39, "And this is the will of him who sent me, that I shall lose none of all those he has given me, but raise them up at the last day. For this is the will of my Father, that everyone who beholds the Son and believes in him will have eternal life, and I myself will raise him up on the last day." John 6:54, "He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day." And it is clear these verses refer to the resurrection from the dead. It says, "on the last day." But they fail to rule out any event before the last day. Nor do they need to. The problem arises from extrapolating a statement to mean more than the statement itself contains, or assuming one promise may prevent an additional promise. A bargain struck with one or some does not rule out a second, separate agreement. Matthew 20, verse 13, "But he answered and said to one of them, Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for a denarius? Is it not lawful for me to do what I will with mine own? Is your eye evil because I am good? So the last shall be first, and the first last. For many be called, but few chosen." Why speak of first and last if we all rise at the same time? Why differentiate between called and chosen at all? This passage speaks of God sovereignly doing his will with his own. I cannot say with absolute certainty this passage refers to the rapture. However, the concepts of first and last, called and chosen, necessitate torturing the explanation otherwise. I agree the rapture is not spelled out in the detail that we might want to demand of God. But I caution us poor mortals from demanding God obey us in the manner we deign acceptable. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.